Thank you, Mr. Wallace, for a well-focused topic. Our next speaker is the consultant of Manila Electric Company. Please welcome Christian Monsod. A round of applause.
I don't have a PowerPoint, so you can just look at me. Good afternoon. The mineral wealth of our country, as the mining industry reminds us, is staggering. Its potential to contribute to our country's development cannot be discounted or ignored. While mining has never been a driver of our development, not even during the mining boom of the 70s, we are here to find out if there is a way to realize that potential. And I thank the organizers of this conference for taking this step towards that objective. The real question before us today is, should mining be allowed in the Philippines? I'll get straight to the point. I believe that we should be open to that proposition, provided four minimum conditions are met. Number one, the environmental, social, and economic costs are accounted for in evaluating mining projects. Number two, the country gets a full and fair share of the value of the extracted minerals. Number three, and this is addressed to the government, the institutional capabilities of the government to evaluate and regulate mining activities are put in place. And number four, since mining uses up non-renewable natural capital, the money from mining are specifically used to create new capital, such as developed human resources and infrastructure, particularly in the rural areas. I refer you to the paper of Professor Ronald Mendoza of the AIM and his proposal for a middle ground that involves the establishment of an inclusive growth trust fund. With respect to downstream plans and the total banning of ore exports, I did not include those because the mining industry has a point on the practicality and long-term feasibility of these conditions, and hence the need for more consultations. I submit that mining is a social justice issue, and we cannot discuss it except in the context of our country's dismal performance in addressing mass poverty and the gross inequalities of income, wealth, and political power that persist more than 25 years after the glowing promise of EDSA, of a just society. We are all familiar with the facts. Over 24 million Filipinos are poor. Poor meaning per capita income of less than 46 pesos a day, price of your coffee. And about 9.4 million of them are food poor, those who live on 32 pesos a day. Not even enough to meet the minimum 2,000 calories a day. Over 24 years, our real per capita income rose only 20%, while those of our neighbors increased: Malaysia 400%, Thailand 500%, China 1,100%, in the process eradicating absolute poverty. Even more compelling, inequality of income has not changed since EDSA. The top 1% of the families, numbering 185,000, all of us in this room, have an income equal to the income of the bottom 30% of the families numbering 5.5 million. There are many more data, but this is not the forum for them. I just wanted to make the point that history has not been very kind to our poor, and we know that must change. The increasing inequality is, of course, worldwide. In our particular case, the root of the problem is a development paradigm followed by every administration: that rising waters raise all boats, that sustained economic growth driven by investments still will eliminate poverty. But conclusive empirical data tell us that sustained high growth is not possible unless we also address the problem of inequality. And that means not only income reform, quality education, healthcare, and livelihood, but also asset reform, which is primarily about land, and natural resources, and a substantive redistribution of their benefits and costs. As you know, we have four of those programs: agrarian reform, urban land reform and enhancing, ancestral domain, and fisheries. It is unfortunate that the stakeholders on the issue of mining, like the National Commission on Indigenous Peoples and the Department of Agriculture, have no voice on this stage. Environmental, social, economic costs and benefits. Mining activities are usually located in rural and mountain areas and can affect farmlands, rivers, shorelines, where the poorest of the poor are located, namely farmers, indigenous peoples, and municipal fishermen. The fact is that mining cannot be conducted without affecting the land, water, and air surrounding the site, as well as the various natural resources found in them. Mining involves extraction of minerals, but may also involve the use or destruction of non-mineral resources such as fresh water, timber, and wildlife. This may also result in health problems, displacement of people, social divisiveness, even the need to provide PNP and AFP protection to mining companies. Then there are the disasters that can happen from the cutting of the trees, from siltation and erosion, and accidents from mining structures. All these translate into public costs. That is why mining and logging are often cited as an example of what Paul Krugman calls activities that privatize benefits and socialize costs. This is the social justice issue in mining. As for the argument that minerals are meant to serve humanity and are the raw materials for modern conveniences, I agree. But the point is that in cases where mining is allowed, the minerals should be priced at full cost, including environmental, social, and economic costs. Otherwise, our poor, who mainly bear these costs, would be subsidizing the consumerism of the rich, both domestic and foreign. We cannot find answers to the plight of the poor until we listen to the poor. You might therefore want to read three public documents: the National Rural Congress of CBCP in 2007, the Climate Change National Consultations of 2009, and the Summit on Poverty, Inequality, and Social Reform in October to December 2011. Why climate change? Because the new normal arising from climate change requires a watershed approach to mitigation, adaptation, and disaster management. And watersheds are where the forests and the minerals are mostly located. In these three conferences, one of the deepest concerns of the poor are the environmental, social, and economic costs of mining. What are the real contributions of mining to GDP, exports, employment, government revenues, investment, industrialization, poverty alleviation? Here are some statistics. As an average contribution to GDP, 0.91, less than 1%. Average share to total employment, 3.76, one-third of 1%. Average contribution of metallic mining to total exports, 2.96%. Average share of mining in investments to total investments, 2.5%. Total government taxes, fees and royalties over from 1997 to 2010, 64 billion, 7.6% of total production value of mining companies of 842 billion. On industrialization, per former NEDA Secretary Shelito Abito, based on national input-output tables, backward linkages of mining, 0.46, less than half of other industries. Forward linkages is a low 0.82. He concludes, this means that mining is not considered enough of a value-adding activity. On poverty alleviation, mining has the highest poverty incidence of any sector in the country, 48.7%. the only sector where poverty incidence increased between 1988 to 2009. The high poverty incidence in areas such as Caraga, Zamboanga Peninsula, Bicol, are about 40-45%, where the national average is 26. We talked about Batarasa. Yes, it's true, poverty incidence is 53%. The mining industry is correct in pointing out that the statistics do not establish causality. I agree with that. But the data at least shows an association between mining and poverty that raises questions on the claim that mining improves the quality of life in its community. Investment and export proceeds. The mining industry's absolute figures on gross investment inflows and export proceeds are impressive. They're only half the picture. Mining companies are allowed to recover and repatriate all pre-operating and development costs up to 4 to 5 years after start of operations. Thus, the inflows and outflows on investment may even out during the period. On export proceeds, mining operations usually front-load production during the first 5 years, understandably to exploit market opportunities. But this also happens to coincide with their tax holidays. Profit remittances can thus be considerable. The DNR says there is a discrepancy between potential excise tax from mining and actual collections, 7.8 billion from 2000 to 2009. Large-scale mining claims, and I think it's true, that their payments in 2008 and 2009 equaled the collectible amount, and that the uncollected excise taxes are attributable solely to small-scale miners and quarrying. That may be true, 2008, 2009. But it's interesting that if one takes a longer view, from 1997 to 2007, there is no such correlation. Actual collections for 6 out of the 11 years are lower than the collectibles from large-scale mining, ranging from 4% to 36%. It is unfortunate that small-scale mining sector was not invited to speak at this conference so it can justify its role in the development of the mining industry. After all, the production value of small-scale mining from 1997 to 2010 was the same as that of large-scale mining at about 300 billion. Employment. The mining industry claims that one direct job in mining creates 5 more jobs in the rest of the economy, or a multiple of 5. NEDA denies that there's such data. However, there is a study by Ms. Madeleine Dumaus based on the 2000 input-output tables of the economy, which shows that, one, a peso change in the final demand for mining and quarrying generates 1 peso and 70 centavos worth of additional output for the economy. On employment, every 1 million of additional investment in mining and quarrying generates additional employment of 2.2, not 5. The average multiplier of 2.2 jobs includes small scale, which requires virtually no capital investment on the one hand. On the other hand, capital-intensive large-scale mining, like Tampakan, that will generate 10,000 temporary jobs and 2,000 permanent jobs with a 5.9 billion investment. That adds up to 120 million per permanent job. The mineral extractive industry is considered worldwide as a low job-generating activity. This data put in question the expansive claim by the chamber that the projected large-scale mining 15 billion investment will generate 70,000 direct jobs that will result in 350,000 other jobs, leading to 2,050,000 jobs by 2018, with 10.25 million Filipinos as direct beneficiaries of mining. a recalculation would look more like 576,000 Filipino beneficiaries. The share of government in mining revenues. The chamber is objecting to the proposed royalty of 5% on mining activities, that it would drive investors to more favorable financial regimes. The industry in November 2011 appealed to the government not to increase the royalties because the, quote, current fiscal regime may be the only thing that's keeping the industry afloat. At the same time, the market is at new highs and the newspapers banner unprecedented mining profits in some companies. To summarize the issue of revenue sharing, very little by way of job generation, little net foreign exchange, relatively small contribution to GDP, very little industrialization. And let me just move on. Wow. The government admits that the Philippine Development Plan, that there is no standard resource and environmental valuation. There is no cost-benefit analysis. The government admits there is no resource mandate. And here NIPAS was mentioned. The government admits that environmental laws, policies, and so on are not and are poorly implemented. Let me just talk later.
Thank you, Attorney Monsod, for your incisive understanding of the business